Cynthia, we're still waiting for the Canadian government to release a new transportation strategy. In the interim, you've penned a piece for RBC, Stronger, Faster, Smarter. Let's talk about some of the key takeaways in the report when it comes to what we need with respect to infrastructure, transportation, and supply chains.
The key takeaways, first of all, that Canada has to do something here. We all know now the importance, have been reminded the importance of transportation infrastructure, and we've got some issues to fix. Our paper really talks about the urgency of doing so, not just for economic growth and consumer satisfaction, but really because Canada is in a race for investment right now. There's a coming global investment boom around decarbonization, around finding trusted suppliers. The US is leading the charge here with major money on the table. Europe is following suit. Canada is actively competing for this investment and has a great proposition, but efficient, sustainable, stable supply chains, transportation infrastructure has to be part of the package. We have 8 recommendations in our report, and I think you can break them down along 3 buckets. One is coordinate, invest, and innovate. So under coordinate, really, we've got to have that supply chain strategy in place. It's been a long time coming, and it can't just be a federal government effort. It needs to really scope in the provinces, needs to scope in investment plans and authorities, and it needs to not just be about what we want our transportation infrastructure to achieve on its own. We have to think about our climate strategies, our climate adaptation strategies, regional strategies, industrial strategies. And we also need better dialogues or deeper relationships. The supply chain is broad and complex. Everyone has a piece of it. We need these better dialogues and better coordination. Second one is to invest. I think we all understand investment in physical infrastructure is a major piece of this, and Canada has some big investment gaps to take care of. But we also have to invest in what we call the soft infrastructure that are going to be just as important, data and AI capabilities to make these supply chains smarter, or workers. The sector is really suffering from shortages of workers more than the average Canadian business. And to innovate, to look at tech, to find new ways for government, industry, and unions to work to enable tech solutions in our supply chains, new revenue models, or even new ways of operating.
You've mentioned that urgency is the priority. What do we have to do to get there?
Yeah, well, I think a lot of the good news is we've had a system that we've seen the gaps of for a couple of years. So we do know that different actors are talking to each other. We do know that a lot of initiatives are underway. The issue is, I think, that some of them are a bit piecemeal, some of them are a bit slow. So it's really about bringing these together and thinking that, if we want, if we need to make a stronger supply chain by adapting it to the effects of climate change, floods, or other natural disasters, that it's going to require major investment. And we've got to have an investment strategy as part of that that includes, the private sector is the lead on that, but some private sector entities, like port authorities, might need new governance models or financing capabilities. And it's also going to include public money. So we need federal and provincial funding plans that follow suit. So I think it's thinking about all the different elements and setting a course. Right now, some of these are moving at different speeds, and I think that's going to hurt us in the end.
Let's just dive into some of the elements that you had just mentioned. Of course, we cannot do anything with climate-related disruptions, but when we talk about something like labor stoppages that we've been seeing in the last little while, how do you think that affects our reputation, specifically, I guess, when it comes to investment?
Yeah, well, Canada is among the group of countries that have a very sophisticated logistics supply chain. It works well. It's invisible when it doesn't, invisible when it works well, sorry. The issue is we've had, a lot of different issues crop up over the last few years. We counted 13 major or potentially major issues over the last 6 years. And these are labor stoppages, they're climate-related events, there's the pandemic in there, or blockades. And each one of these on their own, they're very complex. It's hard to deal with them. But if you think about them holistically, they're a bit of an own goal, something that Canada controls and needs to recognize that in the current environment, there's already so much uncertainty for global investors. Canada's, can't kind of add to that uncertainty by these actions. So it's important to get it right. And there's a lot of different areas to look at. it's not necessarily, the solutions aren't necessarily solving all these in themselves. Some of them are, but for something like climate, we're not going to be able to necessarily change the trajectory of natural weather events. It's the idea of creating more resilience and agility in the system to deal with the implications when it comes.
When you take a look at all the components of infrastructure in Canada, airports, ports, railway, pipelines, roads, is there any one that needs, I guess, immediate attention over the other? Or are they all kind of fair game and they all should be looked at equally?
Well, I think there's going to need to be investment across the supply chain, across all these modes of transport. Different nodes of transport are more important depending on where goods come into the country and where we'll see more growth into or out of the country. So that's a little bit different. But I do want to talk about a couple things here. First of all, that investment, we've seen some areas where investment has kind of fallen behind, certainly, or plateaued in a big way. Our roads serve more than just, as our, transporting freight. They transport people and they're for personal use. So there's that's a big chunk of investment. And we've seen pretty flat investment in that area for a long time. Also, we know in our ports, our marine ports, we've seen like a long infrastructure deficit. Investments picked up with, concerted efforts from federal funding and local port authorities, but it's still only recovering to 1990s level. We've seen a 20-year deficit in this space. And while it is true investment could be, we could get getting more return for every dollar invested, the numbers are just too off. Like we've seen a 50% reduction in investment despite an increase in cargoes. So I think the ports continue to be an area that we really need to look at. And the second thing I want to say here is when we think, as opposed to thinking about the infrastructure holistically and want to break it down by where we need to invest, there's an important strategic question here because there's a difference in how important those are to where we export goods. So if we're exporting to the US, our major trading partner, road and rail are very important. If we're exporting globally, maritime and air are relatively more important. And so Canada needs to, that's the sense in which our strategies need to think holistically about where we're going to play in the world and be supportive of it, because it's going to change where you prioritize for investment.
What is your sense on what the Canadian government will do when it comes to the transportation strategy? Where do you think they will focus?
Well, we've seen some we've seen policy trickling out, I guess you would say, over the last year. We know that there was the National Supply Chain Task Force that issued a final report and advised the government on short, medium, and long-term actions that could be taken. So I think they'll leverage that quite a bit. We've also seen some announcements, a good news story, and legislation that I think has died on the order paper and will be picked back up on in the fall, Bill C-33, that looks to make some changes around governance, around accountability, giving maritime port authorities, for example, more autonomy to manage traffic in their area. So these are all kind of good moves, as well as the National Supply Chain Office out of Transport Canada, which is the idea of one kind of group coordinating, not just across government, but across industry to remove blockades. These are all good things. I think the issue is the pace of movement. We need to see them moving quicker. We need more integrated strategies, more pieces incorporated. It's still a bit piecemeal at this stage.
You mentioned Canada's economic competitiveness. And of course, during the pandemic, post-pandemic, we saw that global trade map shifting, and this word friendshoring was used rather often. How important is this conversation?
It's critical. I think that's the urgency that we're trying to emphasize in our paper. We're competing actively right now for these investments. We have money on the table, as you know, from the federal government and from others. We're pitching for these investments, and they can make a huge difference, not just in decarbonizing our economy, but like really assuring growth and prosperity if done in the right way. And part of that right way is having the infrastructure that supports it. We're going to not be the destination for investment if we can't provide a sure proposition that goods and people can move to where they need to be